RootConf, which is one of the Hasgeek events where we talk a lot about servers and infrastructure. And we suddenly realized that they don't make sense when the network's down. So we had to come around to the fundamental problem of internet shutdowns. And it so happened that most of the techies just assumed that it's not going to come to them or affect them, but it suddenly started to. It's impacting businesses, it's impacting social media, society in ways that we can't really imagine. Well, if I have to take scenarios like farmers, a lot of farmers are complaining that they really don't know what's happening with weather because they have stopped seeing the clouds and relied so much on AccuWeather that they really don't know what's happening with the weather, to when to start plantations. And it's not them directly using it. It's usually their children who just look up it for them and tell them that, oh, there is rain expected and there is snowfall and all of it. So what we are trying to do here is, while it's being helped set up by Hasgeek, Hasgeek is essentially a company which helps tech communities in India to gather together to come towards a safe space where you can learn from each other. And they have a bunch of conferences. RootConf is one where they look at network infrastructure. But they also do Fifth Elephant, which is one on big data. Like we had really interesting talks on how data is affecting our society as well. It's not necessarily more for engineers where they learn about the cloud or they learn about Hadoop and other big data tools. So this event is also being hosted along with Karana. So let me just give you a history of what Karana is and let Kiran do more of the talking. But the idea was to bring in a lot of people in a safe space that we always do to discuss some of these issues. And we increasingly understood that tech is political. And if anybody is disagreeing with it and is saying tech is neutral, we hope some of these talks help you change your views or at least evolve your views, whatever they are. But what we essentially are, a safe space where you can come, just talk, give presentation. And it's usually a submission process where anybody can submit talks. So we also have flash talks planned. We had 4 talks which were confirmed. Unfortunately, I think one of the speakers is a no-show. So we have 3 talks for today. The first talk is on essentially machine-to-machine communications network, which is called LoRaWAN, which is used by Internet of Things sensors to communicate between servers and machines. It's based on radio again. So that's the first talk. Second, we have Farhan, who's also going to explain us setting up a radio-based internet network. And Farhan is a really old-time radio expert who has worked a lot on this space. And the last, we have Community Radios by Ramakrishnanji. So this is the lineup for the talks. And we are also taking flash talks. So if you are interested to talk about internet shutdowns or talk about other alternative technologies that you are working on that could be helped in case of internet shutdowns, I will be asking post the sessions to just raise your hands if you are up for it. And you can just give 5 minutes flash talks on your experiences with internet shutdowns, if you've been through them, or if you're affected by it directly or indirectly. So as I was mentioning, this talk is also happening because of Karana. Karana is a tech collective, which Karana is a rather Indic word, which means reason. Karanam, Karana in multiple languages. So we were formed or we gathered around because of what was happening with tech in India, especially how it has increasingly started taking our society, whether it's a mandatory ID, whether it's internet shutdowns, whether it's facial recognition that's coming up. A lot of net neutrality, for example, was one of the important tech-led movements where people suddenly understood the importance of tech and why we should be concerned about it. So a bunch of us who have been researching a lot into this because of Aadhaar primarily, where we de-emphasized, de-paraphrased, did a lot of research to explain people what's happening with Aadhaar. And it's not very limited to it. So some of us have been working on what's happening with the cloud regulations that try coming up with and how it effectively impacts everyone. So we're just a tech collective, and we are working with Hasgeek to build some of these community spaces where people who understand society and people who understand technology can meet and try to see what's happening with it. In fact, none of the technologists know what's happening with the society, neither do the sociologists who know what's happening with technology. So it's more of the space where we are trying to bring them together. And at this stage, I'll invite Kiran to speak more about the event, and post that we'll start the talks.
So I think we have a bit of time because our first speaker is missing. And first one. Oh, excellent. Okay. So then we'll keep it brief. Okay. So I want to read out from a news article that came a couple of days ago. And this is regarding a hearing in the Supreme Court. Essentially, in September 2018, Justice Bobde had sought for a technological solution to lay out a complete picture of how MCI inspects medical colleges. And the first four sentences of this news article, I think, are very indicative of the environment that we are operating in. So essentially, it says, donning a new role, Infosys co-founder Nandan Nilekani seems to have come to the rescue of the Medical Council of India. The entrepreneur has developed a software for the MCI to streamline inspections of medical colleges across the country. The software aims at minimizing the human interference and devising a uniform yardstick for inspections. On Tuesday, MCI lawyer Gaurav Sharma told the Supreme Court that the software is working fine and has been able to do away with several deficiencies of the past. Mr. Nilekani has given us this software. We have been using this for the last 6 months and it is working very well. Issues of human interference, possible bias, etc. could be taken care of to a large extent. So this is the lawyer who said this to a bench headed by the Chief Justice, Mr. Bobde, again. Okay. Now, just look at what happened here. There seems to be an issue with how a medical college is conducting inspections. And the Supreme Court orders them to appoint Mr. Nilekani in his personal capacity and say, he is an expert. He will do something for you. And Mr. Nilekani delivers on this call. He's been called to produce some software and he does it. He produces the software. He gives it to the medical council. Apparently it works. Okay? And the medical council comes back and reports to the Supreme Court and saying, yes, it worked. You know, that this man who just got told to deliver some software has done it. Okay, and at this point, you have to ask and say, what's going on here? I mean, do you just ask somebody for some software and get it? Or do you have to pay them also? Okay? And does the Supreme Court order you to go approach a very specific individual and say, please give software? And is there no problem of conflict of interest in any form over here? The software now comes in to take on the role of an inspector, and apparently it works. Okay. How does this happen? I mean, how does a piece of software make humans behave? What biases went into the development of that software? What was the role of the creators of the software? Who actually made the software? Mr. Nilekani certainly did not sit down at a computer and start typing out software. He gave the task to someone who produced the software, who then went on to deliver it to the client. So there's essentially a lot hiding behind this idea of simply saying, get some software and fix it. And all of these things are somehow completely missing in a mainstream narrative. And so this is something that we have seen as a society develop over a period of time. That you could say 10 years ago, you bring about this narrative that welfare in this country is full of corruption. And so let's bring some software and make it better. And then Mr. Nilekani gets plucked out of Infosys, brought into the government and said, please develop Aadhaar. And 10 years later, Aadhaar has solved all problems. You know, and you look at this and say, no, this is not magic. Why does it get treated like magic? And so, and mind you, it's also a very successful narrative. I mean, it's the fact is that Aadhaar is pretty much mandatory in life today. And it's mandatory on a government machinery's understanding of it being the perfect solution that actually works. Except we know it does not. You know? And that's something that we have learned the hard way after years of seeing it fail repeatedly. So a few years ago, Srinivas and I and a bunch of others were looking at this and thinking and saying, look, as software developers, we understand that our software never actually works. Okay? It's as frail as we are as humans. And essentially, making software work involves effort, involves compromises, involves mistakes. So it cannot be possible that somebody else's software is perfect. That kind of perfection and this ability to deliver perfection does not exist in humanity. So why does the narrative say the software is value neutral? That it just comes in and solves the problem. And so we set about on a project to document the failings of software. And that really was a Karana project. I mean, we literally had to make a joke about Aadhaar at that point. If Aadhaar is the foundation, let's go after the root cause of foundational assumptions of software working magic. So we started off from there. And over the last couple of years, we have also started looking at how much deeper this magical faith in technology goes and in how many different places does it need to be challenged. So you take internet shutdowns. You know, most of us have never actually experienced a shutdown. We only read about it in the news. I mean, India has the world's largest number of shutdowns, but the likelihood of any of us personally experiencing it is incredibly low. It's mostly because of where these shutdowns happen. They're always targeted, unlike Kashmir, where the entire state is out. Most shutdowns in India are extremely targeted and extremely specific, and it's extremely unlikely that you personally experience them. So, which then becomes a tendency to say shutdowns happen to other people and not your problem at all. So my experience talking to software engineers has again been about a sense of discomfort about talking about shutdowns. Because one, as network engineers, we are the creators of the technology that enables a shutdown to happen or that enables a shutdown to not happen, because we also build networks to be resilient to disruption that is caused by completely accidental factors like people cutting cables when they dig the road. So on the one hand, as network engineers, we build for resilience to ensure shutdowns never happen because usually they happen by accident. On the other hand, we are complicit in the machinery that makes a shutdown happen when government order demands it. And yet, people in technology are uncomfortable talking about it because somehow this is an extremely political thing to discuss. And part of it seems to be that people in tech have bought this image of technology being magical. And that they think it's their responsibility to deliver this magical solution that is disconnected from politics, that is disconnected from the various tussles in society that determine what technology gets built and who builds it and who controls it. So part of what we're trying to do is open up the dialogue a little bit and say, we have to get technologists to understand that politics is not just BJP versus Congress, that politics is far, far bigger field, and all technology is political, even if you don't realize it. And a mainstream narrative that simply says this is not how technology works needs to be challenged in itself, because that's actually not how technology works.